fading bullet.
If you only knew the power of the dark side.
More powerful than a locomotive.
Halt! Smash!
Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
I have
the power! Up in the sky! It's a bird!
I am Batman!
It's a plane!
There's more to them than meets the eye.
Yo there, boils and ghouls, Chuckles the Clown here, live, or dead as you may say, here on Rhode Island Free Radio. It's this Chuckles Crypt, and we're going to talk about a lot of great stuff tonight, but not before I introduce my cast, as always. George Garner across the table.
Greetings.
The lovely Nurse Misery sporting an awesome Captain America shirt. This is probably going to be the last time for a while that Nurse Misery will be on our show. So we're going to try to make this a good one. We know why, because there's an evil seed that's about to spawn amongst this world and to take you all over and turn you into mindless zombies.
Chuckles, let me ask you this. How many reincarnations, or should I say, how many children have you spawned over all your reincarnations?
I cannot account for any of them but this one. The other ones, I usually left them before there was a Black Plague or whatever it was. This is the only one I can account for. And God help the world, because this one's going to be a female version of me. So,
well, you know, there's going to be some me in there, too. Just means she's going to be a more cynical jerk than you.
That's hard to think of. That really is a hard one to think of.
You with more sarcasm and a worse attitude.
That is very hard to think of. But on a good side, we are in August, and we kind of celebrate a holiday that's weird today, and I'll get to that before I get to the song. Yes, it is good, Nurse Misery, because now we're closer to September and October.
Okay. But August is hot and gross.
But, you know, this one hasn't been that bad yet in Rhode Island yet. And we're the second week into it, and it really hasn't. I mean, those last two weeks in July in Rhode Island were pretty brutal. But this one's pretty good, and it's getting. I'm getting the itch, the fall itch. I'm seeing that the dollar store has started to release its Halloween stuff slow but surely, and it puts a little smile on my face when I see that. You know, and I see people looking for job applications and opportunities, which, by the way, Scary Acres. Yes, if you're looking for a job this fall, come work with me at Scary Acres.
Which, by the way, it legitimately crossed my mind to get a job at Spirit Halloween because they offer their employees 30% off. So I'm thinking I take the minimum wage job for a couple nights a week, and I get 30% off, and I make, you know, double in buying merchandise.
Yeah, why not?
By the end of the season, you can get 30% off that 75% clearance, and damn.
Especially if you're in a band or a television show, working at that place isn't a bad idea.
Not to mention all the discounts of the stuff that falls off the truck.
Yeah, lightings. All sorts of good stuff coming out there. But that makes me excited. I see some up-and-coming flavors of pumpkin and everything. I know someone out there is going to say, ew, gross pumpkin. Maybe someone inside this room. But I enjoy it. Yeah, we could sit down and watch our debut of the Flash or Arrow or whatnot that's coming out.
With the season premieres coming out in September. And all the kids are going back to school in like the next 2 weeks.
Yeah,
so
take that, you rotten bastards.
The rats are going to be off the sidewalks.
Yep, that's right. And
their damn Pokemon Go getting run over at 10 in the morning.
Well, aren't you in a rather peculiar time of your life to be taking a negative attitude toward children?
Mine is going to be a little too small to be running around in the middle of the road with a cell phone.
We can only hope.
Looking like a fool.
Well,
we can hopefully teach her to utilize a sidewalk. That's my goal in life, for her to be smart enough to use a sidewalk.
One of the shows I'm very excited to see this fall, we didn't get a chance to see last season, and I'm hoping they're going to put up the first season again, because I guess they started it over and I'm still lost, is Supergirl. I'm really excited to see this. She's one of my favorite DC characters. And I'm very eagerly anticipating this merge to see this, because it's going to be they're doing Flashpoint for Flash. They're doing the new 52 for Supergirl. And Arrow, I have no clue where they're going with that. And nor do I have a clue where they're going with Legends, besides bringing in the JSA, which is really flipping awesome. I mean, as far as television goes, DC is kicking the crap out of Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. The Inhumans is cool, and Agent Carter was cool, but it is nowhere near the awesomeness of these shows right now.
Well, it seems like Marvel and DC they've decided that's their considered strategy, right? DC is going to attack TV. Marvel is pretty much sticking with the movies.
Marvel is nailing it with the movies. However, we will get to that movie in a little bit. And yes, I am talking about Suicide Squad. I will review parts of that to try not to give too much away. But I'll go over my opinions of it later on. And of one of the movies that you wouldn't really like think I would be reviewing today, Sharknado 4.
Why?
Because we were gone for so long that I couldn't really bring it up in between there, so I gotta do it now.
I think you're using the term movie loosely.
Yeah.
Sci-fi special?
You know, we'll get to that in a little bit, but let's go down to some music. And like I said, today we're celebrating a very special holiday, and this music goes really well with this holiday we're celebrating. It's called Slap A, and then we put a beeper there, Day, basically celebrating the fact that we nuked the crap out of Japan today.
Oh, my goodness. Oh,
yes.
I didn't even realize that when I put that
song up next. Thank you, world.
That's awesome.
Thank you, Nurse Misery. This one made it's probably the best runner-up of my show yet. The song following that up, Godzilla by the Blue Oyster Cult. Enjoy this.
We're the purposeful
happy birthday to you, Godzilla, right here on Chuckles Crypt, RhodeIslandFreeRadio.org. We are sending a happy birthday out to the monster and the machine itself. Today, I would say that today would officially be Godzilla's birthday.
A happy birthday to the atomic age.
That's right. Happy birthday, Mr. Godzilla. You've brought in hours of entertainment to us, which we're going to talk about later on the Haunted Cabaret. So stay tuned if you're a Godzilla fan. Or don't stay tuned, and stay tuned anyways. But I was asked over the break, why Sharknado? And George is shaking his head, and everybody in here is shaking their head. And if you had asked me this about, I'd say,
2 years ago
when I first watched it myself, the first one, and I said, man, this movie is horrible. And I was taken into the fact that it was supposed to be something that it wasn't. That movie was meant to be horrible. All right, it was 100%
campy and ridiculous.
Our generation's version of the Attack of the Killer Tomatoes. It was meant to be campy, and it was meant to be, oh my God! But you can't sit there with those movies, any of them, and watch them by yourself because they're not enjoyable. Because then your mind concentrates too much on how really horrible these movies are.
Well, see, Chuckles, that's the thing. It's like, they're intentionally horrible.
Right.
See, to me, funny, I mean, really like ridiculous, like hurt yourself laughing funny, is movies that are not supposed to be bad, but they are anyway. See, that to me is funny. Like any of the Emmerich Brothers movies, like those are just hilariously funny because they're supposed to be important, but they're stupid.
I'm going to give them credit. A lot of their scenes are pretty funny. I mean, there's some of this stuff like when they're attacking the Daily Show or taking out, you know, Good Morning Show and the sharks are getting them. That's some pretty funny stuff there. Not only just because I hate that cast, it's just it's funny that these folks would put themselves out for this movie and to do it. And the two main characters, they've reappeared throughout the whole series, which I got to give them kudos for that because usually a crappy movie like that, you do it once and you're done.
If you watch all four over the years, you can just see how terribly Tara Reid has aged. I mean, she looks like hell.
I still would. I definitely still would. And I'm looking forward to meeting her at Comic-Con.
Actually, that's one of the surest signposts that a cast from a movie will be at Comic-Con is that they appear in the same shitty series of movies, four movies in a row.
But it is awesome. I mean, and you can predict which horrible actors are going to end up in these movies, too. Like, I'm sitting down there, and I'm like, this is a movie David Hasselhoff would be in. Boom. The third one, David Hasselhoff's in it. Then I'm sitting there, and I'm saying, wow, you can't have the Hoff without having the crazy man himself, Gary Busey.
Right.
Boom. Gary Busey's in it. It's like, oh, well, there we go.
There were so many cameos in the fourth one.
The fourth one was really cool. I have to say this because they touched on my dark heart a little bit, and they paid tribute to Gunnar Hansen. It was his last movie he was in. And they did it in Texas at one point in time with chainsaws, and he got out there with a chainsaw and was cutting up the sharks and everything. They had the original Christine car in it, which was really cool. And there was all these little bits and pieces that they were paying homage to throughout the horror thing. So they know that what they're doing is silly, but it's still silly funny, and it's getting the point across. And it's become one of those movies where you don't have to pay money to go to the movie theater to see it, because then that would be a waste of time.
Well,
I mean, there are some people that
worth $1.50.
They have put them in the movie theater before. But sitting at home and watching them with television, with your buddies and everything, taking a shot every time you see a shark come out of a twister and bite someone's head off, becomes a fun event.
I was even impressed with Sci-Fi's shamelessness.
Oh, yes.
They shamelessly promoted another series or movie.
Yeah,
that
lava
was
spiders.
Out.
Lava tarantulas.
Like, oh my God, that is amazingly terrible. Kudos to you for being so
shameless. They had the what do they call him? The guy from Police Academy.
Yeah, I can't remember his name. Steve Buscemi?
No. Gooey something, whatever.
Yeah.
He appeared because his career is definitely down the toilet now, and all he does
is... one of those, like, has-been names. And
you know, the thing is, too, with him is he disappeared for a long period of time. Like, after the Police Academy movies and all that, he disappeared. And now he comes back and does these cheesy B-rated slasher, and then down to, like, I would probably say the D-rated Sharknado movies, because you can't put those in. They're a category all of their own, and they are fun. Don't go into it like I first did and say, oh, this is stupid. Like, yeah, it's stupid, but it's supposed to be stupid.
Speaking of stupid, the Sci-Fi Channel, I'm thinking when stupid comes to mind to me, I think of that teen star from, there was Tiffany from the 80s. Debbie Gibson. Yeah, she was in a sci-fi series of movies.
She was in a couple stuff. She was also in one where...
And the great thing was, which was the one where she tried to play a scientist?
That's the one where she got eaten by the giant crocodile. Okay. It was like Dinosaur Croc versus Robo Shark.
Okay.
Robo Megadon. That one was one.
Yeah, that one was painful.
Now, that was funny. Debbie Gibson trying to look intelligent.
I'll have to... If the listeners out there want to know a story about Mrs. Debbie Gibson, send me a message, and maybe I'll blog it to you guys. I'll put it up on the blog. Let's just put it that way, because there's some parts to her that not a lot of people know about that I didn't so much find out as I walked into. So I know that sounds very interesting, so I'll put that up there on the blog, and we'll talk about that, and... We come back, we're going to talk a little more about some up-and-coming television shows, and there's a really good one coming up, and everybody's looking forward to it. It's not till October, unfortunately, but we'll talk about some of this stuff. All right, let's go down to Every Breath You Take by The Police. What a stalker song here on Chuckles Crypt, Rhode Island Free Radio.
Step you take, I'll be watching you.
Police here on Rhode Island Free Radio, Chuckles Crypt, and that's what I would be hearing if I played that song for one of my exes or some young lady that I found attractive. The police definitely would be at my door, but somehow Sting, he got away with it. The man.
Well, it was clever marketing. Yeah. I mean, they marketed it as a love song.
Now, for all you folks out there that are a rock and roll fan like myself, Sting has a new rock and roll album he is in works of right now. Doesn't know, hasn't said when it's going to release, hopefully soon. And I think they said it was, don't quote me, that it was with the police. So it's kind of like the original band's back together putting another rock album out. I would definitely pay a couple bucks to go see that. I think I'd pay a couple bucks to go see Sting, period.
Yeah.
And here on Chuckles Crypt, I'd be renounced if I did not mention that today, this day, not only is it Godzilla's birthday, but it is the birthday of the best Transformers movie ever made. The 1980s version of Transformers, which had Weird Al Yankovic on it and a bunch of awkward music on there. And some of the Transformers that we would love to hate would debut on that show. One of my favorite Transformers movies, it is the best Transformers movie. I saw a picture up there on, what do they call it, The Face, and it had the original Megatron holding the movie's Megatron's head in his hand, saying, "This is what I think of your Megatron." Really, really the best movie on there, and I don't, you know, I'm going to say this, I don't think there's going to be anything that's going to top that. I mean, probably because I have a strong part to that, but it also makes me feel a lot older in my third coming. 30 years.
Damn.
Man, where has time gone? 30 years since one of the best Transformers. And if you youngins are out there, and I'm starting like it sounds like an old clown, have not seen the original Transformers movie, shame on you. Do so now. It's easy to obtain. It's easy to see a copy of it. You can sit there. You can watch some original Transformers movies, and when you're done, you can read some Godzilla comic books and maybe watch the movies to celebrate these monumental birthdays in history today. I don't care about anybody else's birthday. I'm not talking about them. But to celebrate that stuff is awesome. Now, you said, why the fall? Why September, October? There are great shows coming out for that. And
I was more like, why would you be happy as August? Was
because you're
thing.
Closer to September and October.
But yeah, I understood you that know? After the fact. I mean,
this is my lead up to Christmas. This is where I start to celebrate and put out Halloween stuff.
We usually do start planning the Halloween right. action and all that. It's just the hot and the humidity.
And they start replaying The Walking Dead by now. To get you ready for October.
Or at least they're advertising that the marathon will be kicking up soon.
And I cannot wait to see who they took out. It's really got me on edge.
It better not be Daryl. That's all I care about.
I got a feeling.
Kill Carl. Don't kill Daryl.
I got a feeling it is. Because when I'm sitting there watching AMC and I see he has his own television show coming
don't
out.
Say such evil things.
I don't know. It's kind of hard to rock.
I'll stab you in your sleep.
It's hard to rock two television shows. It really is. The guy's from England. He's coming over here, and he's doing a show about touring America on a bike. That's not something that's even done in a day. So it's hard to film two shows like that.
Shut up,
so,
clown.
I know, shut up, clown, but Hey, it makes sense. He's the only other one in there that is an actual fictional character and never existed on The Walking Dead. So that director does not care what you think. He will kill that character off, whether you like it or not.
He's expendable.
Yeah, that's why he is such a great director, because none of those people on that show
matter.
They are not safe.
Let's not make the 37-week pregnant woman cry on air, please.
I would love to. That's an evil clown thing. I would love to do that.
And I give those guys credit. When we've seen them at Rock and Shock and at the Comic-Cons, they will not spill the beans. They will not even...
They
must be under some kind of a contract where they're screwed if they disclose anything. I mean, they are tight-lipped.
I would think so, because we met Scott Wilson, and he hadn't passed away yet on his season. But you knew it was coming. And a bunch of us tried asking him, like, who's going to get the axe next? Who do you think's going to get the axe next? And he couldn't even answer who he thought. He would just say, I can't talk about that. I could talk about prior seasons or some of my other acting careers, but I can't talk about that. So that was one. And, of course, one that Tony Jones and I look forward to coming up, The Simpsons Treehouse of Horror.
Very true.
I look forward to that every year. And now I start getting excited. I start rewatching some of the old Treehouses of Horror.
On the FX.
What's your favorite one?
Marathon. Oh man, that's tough.
It is. Yeah, they have some really good ones.
I probably like the one where the generic Transformers come alive and start killing the Simpsons when her little Malibu Barbie.
That was a pretty thing. Classic.
That's probably one of my favorites. Probably because I'm a diehard Transformer fan. That's probably why. I'd say that.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that this fall will bring some more of this, what they call high C ecto cooler out, the best thing that came out of the Ghostbusters crap, which at the end of the show, I forgot to give Nurse Misery her 5 seconds of fame, what she thought of that. I'm going to give her that. I'm going to blank myself out with this medication on the table so I don't get aggravated and drop the F-bomb again. That was a very expensive F-bomb. I'm going to give you that 5 minutes.
At this point, is it really even worth it?
Sure it is. It's still in the theater. Sure it is. Nail it to the cross as long as you can. Let that SOB bleed out amongst the floor.
I'm just worried if it deserves more airtime.
It sure does. And I tell you a movie that does deserve airtime, and we're going to get to it. I promise you. We're going to talk about Suicide Squad.
We'll be better. That's why I'm like, I don't want to talk about Ghostbusters. I'd rather talk about Suicide Squad.
We are going to talk about Suicide Squad. Up next is that's what we're going to talk about. But right now, we're going to go down to Oingo Boingo, Just Another Day.
There's life underground. I feel it all around. I feel it in my bones. My life is on the line when I'm away from home. When I step out the door, the jungle is alive. I do not trust my ears. I don't believe my eyes. It's just another. We'll be right back.
always disappear before the morning light. I'm dreaming again, the knife in the ground. It doesn't ever move, it doesn't make a sound. And just when I think that things are in place, the hands are secure, the hope it explodes in my face.
Yeah, just another day. You can never say that if you are affiliated or you hang out with anybody from the Chuckles and Laughs show. There is never such a thing as just another day. No. Boingo, boingo. And you heard him earlier, Danny Elfman with the Batman theme. So give you another surprise for that. And why not? Because there is a theme today's show, which is movie reviews and television and good stuff that's coming up to get you guys excited for the fall. But before the summer leaves, let me give you a taste of what I think is one of DC's best live-action films that they have done. And someone out there is going to say, oh, what about the Christian Bale Batmans and the Supermans? And yes, they're
blah,
good.
Blah, blah.
But this was incredible.
Yes.
If you are a comic nerd, which we all are here, this one follows the story closest to any damn movie out there. Right down to the fact where everybody keeps saying that the guy that plays the Joker is horrible. He did a bad job. In actuality, he did the best job.
He's the closest to the comic.
Yeah, this guy researched that comic for years, months on end. And plus, he loves the character, the Joker. So he was able to slip into this very easily, to the point where he put a tattoo of a smiley face on his arm, and he uses that when he goes around now. So this guy's going to become the new Joker. Like it or not, he is. And it really was
incredible.
The Joker's mindset. And the other characters, awesome.
They all stood on their own,
they
too.
Did. Killer Croc had a couple moments where he was CG. Otherwise, it was practical makeup. Which was
Killer Croc is one of my favorite Batman villains.
Oh man, it's going to do you well.
Amazing.
Then when you see what they do to him, I'm not going to ruin too much, like I said though. But you're going to enjoy it. I will say that it's very enjoyable. Harley Quinn finally got a little bit of story time. A lot of people don't realize that Harley is a brand new character to the Batman universe.
Compared
she was
to all the rest.
Right.
She's the baby.
She was a cartoon character. She was never in the comics.
What was it, mid-90s?
Yeah,
came
so
out?
Cartoons.
Or early 90s.
Yeah, well, they do it with this. And she's got her own comic series now.
Yeah, now.
But this is the first big debut of Harley Quinn.
Yeah.
Excellent job. And the woman that played her, oh my God, she is gorgeous. I used to have my favorite Harley Quinn impersonator, but unfortunately, young lady, you've lost your spot. I have to say, I have to meet this young woman that played her because she is gorgeous, bubbly, and
but
plays the character well.
A twisted person.
Yeah, very, very well.
Like, you can't keep your eyes off of her, and it's not just because her butt looks amazing.
And of course,
it's
they bring
you
in.
You want to see what she does next.
Arguus has their members in it, and then you have Cantana, which is not a part of the Suicide Squad. We all know that. She's actually part of other stuff like Justice League Dark.
But
so are they going to bring that fashion in?
The woman who plays Katana, she really owns that role as well.
That was good. I mean,
female characters in this owned their roles.
Boomerang, Captain Boomerang, really liked him.
He's such a turd,
but
it
I'm
worked.
A Rogue fan, so I liked it. And the guy that played him did a really good job of playing him.
Yeah, he played him like a goofy turd thief.
And the Rogues are one of those characters where they're really cool fashion of villains, but they are goofy. You really can't take them as serious as some other villains.
Right.
Like, you look at Deadshot, and then you look at Captain
right.
Boomerang, and you're
like,
oh, my word.
Will Smith, hands down, I have to clap for you for that. excellent job playing Deadshot. Really,
he
really cool.
Good too.
Very convincing. Very convincing Deadshot, the way he played it and everything. And seeing him interact with Batman
change.
Again, which, yes, Batman does show up again. And, yes, he does a really good job. And it's the one you guys were poo-pooing on. All in all, I give this movie probably an 8 out of 10.
But you did forget to mention the guy that plays Diablo.
Diablo was awesome. I wasn't going to spoil that for them. I didn't want them...
Well, you don't have to say what happens. I'm just saying. Right. He's a good character and everyone knows he's in it.
And if you like Breaking Bad, he's one of the actors from Breaking Bad, one of the Spanish fellows, which he slips into this character pretty cool. I don't want to ruin too much of that because you really easily could spoil it if you talk anymore.
Yeah, well, it was a character just to
it's watch awesome.
The development of
all the
and
characters.
Develop him well.
Even the colonel, the lady that played the head of Arguis, she was great.
Yeah.
Those names always slip me. I don't know why.
But
they do.
I want to say Captain, I don't remember.
Captain Flynn, I think, right?
Flynn or Flagger.
Yeah.
Something with an F.
I think Flag sounds better.
Yeah, Flag something.
But I'm going to say, all in all, an 8 out of 10. Really. Really was. I can't give it a 10 out of 10 because there was some spots I could argue with that I won't until after you watch the movie. But I don't think it's as horrible as the critics gave it.
Because
I really
you know more about comics than you could take away a few extra points. Me having less knowledge of some of these characters.
Yeah, well, I noticed one thing. I noticed that seems to be a trend going on these days. The superhero movies that the critics hate the most of, we usually like the best.
That's what it is. It's like, oh, they pooed all over the Batman, Superman. They pooed all over this one. And granted, yes, the Avenger movies are good. And they are a little better than...
But this is darker, so they can't talk about it as much.
I mean, these
they
are...
They can't like it as much.
These are supervillains doing what supervillains do.
This wasn't meant for your five-year-old.
No. It's meant for all us out there that like the bad guys. Like myself, George, you, Tony, we like the bad guys. So to see the bad guys in the spotlight instead of being the contrast of the guy... That's just going to get their butt kicked and killed in 5 seconds was really cool.
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons I like the Suicide Squad is it does put a nice light on it. And, okay, we did forget another one, the Enchantress.
Yeah.
That's probably the two parts that I could.
GB stuff.
The it is. The Enchantress, from her history in comics. Depending on who is writing the story and who is, depending on how she's portrayed, she can either be obnoxious or she can be a really good character.
Oh, she was a good character.
On,
she was dark
because I know over the years in the comics she's been both.
Yeah,
depending on how she's used.
That was probably the one complaint I had with the movie was the Enchantress. That's why I don't give it a 10 out of 10 because there were some parts of that. I didn't seem to enjoy the special effects of her and everything were kind of cheap. I'd have to give that. I mean, those effects were something that I would have seen on X-Files or something. Like, they weren't really that great. So they kind of slacked with that apartment. 8 out of 10, you gave it a 9 out of 10 because Nurse Misery doesn't read a lot of those villains besides...
Some of them were honestly new to me.
Besides your best with Harley Quinn. But other than that, it's really cool.
I was just happy to see her have real story arc on her own, and they built her as a character away from Joker.
Yeah, and I liked how Joker had the Joker attitude, which I think a lot of the times, a lot of the people that play the Joker miss that.
Yeah.
Like, they try to stay too much on point A or too much on point B. They don't
have to blend, and he did a good job blending.
Well, when we talk about Joker attitude... Joker is kind of like, he's like a lot of long-running comic characters. It depends, the old question, which Joker are we talking about?
Yeah.
This is definitely the comic Joker that they pulled out. The same type of Joker that would have been in, Killing Joker or Joker King, something like that.
So this isn't the Heath Ledger Joker that just wanted to destroy for the sake of destruction.
No, not at all. And if you're a young lady, you'll like this Joker a lot more than the Heath Ledger one. He's got that touch of romance to him that the ladies like. But the Joker did.
He was very suave.
He had that soft spot for Harley towards, the new rebirths of her. So let's go down to some music here, and I'm going to give Nurse Misery her chance to say what she feels about the Ghostbusters movie, since I forgot to. Always on Your Side by Sheryl Crow and Sting. Well, this song goes really good with the Joker and Harley. Harley Quinn. This definitely fits them in the movie. Let's go down to that.
My yesterdays are all boxed up and neatly put away. But every now and then you come to mind. 'Cause you were always waiting to be picked to play the game. But when your name was called, you found a place to hide. When you knew that I was always on your side. Everything was easy then, so sweet and innocent. But my demons and my angels reappear, leaving only traces of the man you thought I'd be. Too afraid to hear the words I'd always feared. Leaving you with only questions all these years.
Sheryl Crow and Sting. She's still a beautiful woman. Very beautiful and great
cougar
voice. Yes, definitely a cougar that I wouldn't mind being attacked by. RhodeIslandFreeRadio.org. And yes, you were listening to Chuckles Crip. We're going to go down to Nurse Misery in a couple seconds. And she's going to give you her review of the Ghostbusters and a couple stuff that's up and coming. But I would be remiss if I didn't say this. If you guys heard that song, and I said before that that's dedicated to the Joker and Harley Quinn, we're going to give you guys a competition. See out there to see who can make the best Harley Quinn Joker music video. And send it my way, the Chuckles and Laughs Show, and either through our website or Chuckles and Laughs Show through family, through Facebook. And the winner, I'll send out a pair of A pair of t-shirts for you. A pair of Chuckles the Clown t-shirts. So those are $20 values.
T-shirt, yeah. And even a full set of season one DVDs.
Yeah, well,
whatever
this is your
choose.
You guys got, I'd say, about what, a week, maybe 2 weeks. Well, I'll give you two weeks from today to make that video.
Again.
You guys can do this, and then I'll announce
the
winner.
Which song should they use? Do you want them specifically to use the
Oh, yes. They have
side?
To use the Sheryl Crow and Sting, Always on Your Side. They have to, because I think that would be a good song to make with that. All right, Nurse Misery, let them go on your Ghostbusters review.
So for Ghostbusters, now we're talking. It's been like two more weeks, and I've forgotten most of the decent parts of it because there really weren't any in the first place.
I think you just gave your review.
So, yeah.
Very concise.
From the female point of view, they were actually more chauvinistic, those women, than any of the comments people put. They had the classic attitude of the sexist one, the lead female, where all she did was ogle the guy that plays Thor and drooled over him like he was a piece of meat, and they treated him like a piece of meat, which I thought was very distasteful. I'm like, you guys are complaining about sexism. Your entire movie is sexist. And it was just kind of...
So you're
going to
say
it
sucked, right?
Yeah, it was boring.
I thought, what was the point of that? I thought this was going to be a rebuttal to Chuckles the Clown saying it sucked.
Nope.
He just wanted the female point of view, and I'm like, well, the female point of view from my perspective is that their movie was just as sexist as all of the comments. So it sucks,
but for different reasons.
It sucks because...
For many reasons.
Yeah, for many reasons.
Too many reasons to count.
Because... The female Slimer, horrible. Horrible.
Yeah, that was
horrible.
Stupid.
Unnecessary.
So let's not give this movie any more airtime than we already have. I just wanted to give a fair review from the female side, which I did say I was going to do, and I forgot to last episode. Yes. So let's talk about what's up and coming and a store that's one of my favorites.
Well, the first thing up and coming this coming weekend at Seaport World Trade Center is going to be Boston Comic Con. August 12th, 13th, and 14th.
I will be there in gear, all things promised, but I will not be there having a table. I will be there to sign.
Seeing Chuckles around.
Yeah, I will be there, and you'll probably see me with the Flash and the Arrow characters because a good portion of them are going to be at this Comic-Con.
Oh, not Fat Flash.
You know, yeah. He's never showed up. He's never showed up to take his vengeance.
I didn't even see him at last Comic-Con.
I think he's probably dead in his basement somewhere from a glitter
like,
bomb.
It's like that
somewhere.
Guy Happy that was on the Jerry Springer show years ago. They're going to have to remove a wall to get Fat Flash out of his house.
Yeah, he's even fatter now. He's Whale Flash.
And
of course, if you guys are looking for some comic needs or maybe some cool Star Wars action figures, where can they go for that?
They can go over to Rubber Chicken Comics, which is at the Plaza at Bellingham Commons, 15 North Main Street in Bellingham, Mass. They always have great deals going on, usually on the weekends. A lot of times they have sidewalk sales. Check out their Facebook. There's almost always something going on.
They're very friendly, and they're not distracted by playing magic. They will help you out and get you the comics you need.
Yes,
I agree.
They're all very knowledgeable.
Yes, you need to separate the two. You can't be selling magic cards and comic books in the same spot. It's just too much of a distraction for us nerds. It just can't be done. So we're going to go out with a little song I like from ZZ Top, and I'm going to play this song out there for all the young ladies from Flash and Arrow. This song is dedicated to you from Chuckles the Clown here on Chuckles Crip, Rhode Island Free Radio.org. Coming up next on Cabaret. Give me all your lovin', ZZ Top.
sound of footsteps in the dark, to voices that may not be quite human, to the sound of screams in the night, the haunted cabaret, the home of all things horror, on Rhode Island FreeRadio.org, with your host, George Garner. The Haunted Cabaret starts now.
It was long ago, seemed like yesterday. Saw you standing in the rain. Then I heard you say, I want to love, but it comes out wrong. I want to live, but I don't belong. I close my eyes and I see blood roses. More flowers in the springtime. October we were wet. Winter time, the roses died. The blood ran cold, then she said, I want to love, but it comes out wrong. I want to live, but I don't belong. I close my eyes and I see blood and roses.
This is the Haunted Cabaret here on Rhode Island Free Radio. I'm your host, as usual, George Garner. In the studio with me, Chuckles the Evil Clown.
Cool evening to you.
Nurse Misery. And at our control panel, as usual, Tony Jones.
And by the way, the Smithereens, a band that has been known to listen to Rhode Island Free Radio from time to time because they've messaged us in and, you know, thanked us for playing their stuff.
Nice. And I'll tell you, the Smithereens, that particular album, was that especially for you, if I'm not mistaken, that Blood and Roses comes from. I'll tell you, back in the, I guess you would say back in the day of vinyl, there was side one and side two. And that side B of that Smithereens album is one of the most awesome rock albums in the history of the world. The Smithereens has some recognition, but they deserve more.
Not so far back in the days of CDs, that CD just lived in my car for maybe like a year and a half.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, Behind the Wall of Sleep, Blood and Roses, Hand of Glory. See how well the songs come right back to me. Yep. That's what I would do. I would start with now side one is fine, but it's more of a rock and roll side one. Side two is the one with all the Black Magic tinged, you know, stuff that I love best.
Yeah, side two is if you met a girl at Club Hell and she's coming back to your place and you need some background music.
You just put that sucker on and let it play.
Yep. Let it do it for you.
Exactly. As far as doing things for me, now, I would be remiss if I didn't start off this show by mentioning that the best thing that anyone ever did for me, besides first sex, was probably dropping those atomic bombs on Japan.
Oh, good God.
I mean, now granted, yes, and you say, well, yeah, but Hiroshima and Nagasaki, those atomic bombs basically murdered and wiped out a few hundred thousand people. Well, yeah, they did, but then I don't care. Because what they also did is they gave us Godzilla and a whole range of giant monster movies reaching out to the horizon as far as the eye can see. And as far as I'm concerned, that not only justifies the atomic bombings, but it also justifies World War II. I mean, Chuckles, would you argue with that? I mean,
I plead the fifth.
Yeah, Chuckles is smiling. Chuckles agrees with that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, the other thing I would have to say, now I'll touch on real history for a second. I mean, I can justify that statement two ways. One, because I just said it and I believe it and I'm a huge Godzilla kaiju fan. The other one is that I've never heard a country whine so much about wartime atrocities committed on them as Japan, when Japan was the one who committed as many wartime atrocities in World War II as the Third Reich. And for some reason, Japan usually gets a free pass on this, except by the Chinese, who for some reason, now, I don't know why it is, but the Chinese somehow remember back in those days when the Japanese raped entire cities of Chinese women with their bayonets. For some reason, the Chinese have long memories when it comes to that. They call it the Rape of Nanking for a reason. And then the Japanese have the nerve, the colossal nerve, the Godzilla-sized nerve, to turn around and complain about America dropping a couple of atomic bombs on them. By the way, you know, after they put our troops through the Bataan Death March, all kinds of fun stuff.
I don't want to turn this into history talk with George Garner here.
We're going to get off history tour right about now.
I think the whole Pacific Theater was particularly nasty. I mean, it fits in perfectly for a horror show because my own grandfather was in the Pacific Theater in World War II and disliked Asian people to the day he died. And I've seen the pictures. I've heard the stories. And the VFW hall not too far from here, I remember as a young guy sitting in there and hearing the stories from all the World War II vets. And there's a distinct difference from the guys who served in Europe and the guys who served in the Pacific Theater. I mean, it was nasty over there.
Right. And nastiness breeds nastiness, which is why, well, I guess the other thing that breeds nastiness is that when you spend a couple of billion dollars to, you know, come up with a new weapon, you're going to drop it on somebody.
You got to test it.
You got to play with your toys.
Yeah, and I can't think of a better bunch of people to drop it on than our Japanese friends. Because, like, it brought us Godzilla. You know, because actually that's how we got Godzilla, is that 9 years after the fact, the Japanese, again, whining about their treatment at the hands of the United States during the war, wanted to show the effects of all this radioactivity on Japan. But you can't just go and make a movie about your enemy's so-called atrocities when they just kicked your ass 9 years ago. You know what I'm saying? That's not going to happen. So what the Japanese did is they made a monster movie, you know, ostensibly just for the purpose of entertainment, which showed the effects of radiation on a civilian population. And that was the origin of Godzilla. In other words, it started off with a very serious intent, put it that way. Of course, then after the first movie, it became a financial blockbuster. And what would you say? Commercialism triumphed over radioactivity and the oxygen destroyer. And we had an endless series of Godzilla films from there. So, the subject of this week's Haunted Cabaret is Godzilla.
Woohoo!
And Chuckles. We've had... actually, you know what? Count these last. I used to know exactly to the T the number of movies, of Godzilla movies we've had. I have lost count over the last few. I know that... Well, actually, let's jump to the very latest. You said, right, Toho has produced a new Japanese film.
Yep, brandy new.
In response to the American Godzilla.
Yep, yes they have. Yep. And it got released to certain theaters into America, which none of them were close to us.
Right.
And, of course, everywhere in Japan.
Right.
So.
And word is?
Well, the word is that everybody enjoys it. It has been a really cool movie, but this is the problem we're going to run into this. I know you might have an issue with this. Godzilla is mostly CG'd. Oh. All right? It's not suited. I know you. I saw that look. I saw that. If you guys could have seen this, I knew it was coming. Mm-hmm. And from what I hear, I haven't seen it. Don't know if it's true. The Japanese are not subbed. They're actually speaking English. So two things that
are bizarre.
Normally cheesy and whatnot.
But the Japanese are speaking English in a Japanese-produced movie released in Japan?
I think they're speaking English over into the American one. I don't know what they're doing over in the Japanese one.
Unless it's possible they might have shot it in Japanese, then dubbed it themselves in Japan.
Possibly.
And sent it over here. That makes the most sense.
Yeah, they possibly would have. But from what I hear, everybody's liked the movie. Although, I mean, minus the fact that it is mostly CG'd and...
Yeah, well, CG is not always... As much as I hate it...
It's not a bad thing.
It's not always bad. I mean, right. I remember one of my favorite Godzilla films is Godzilla, Mothra, and King Ghidorah, all giant monster all-out attack. And what they did in that one is they used the suitmation, but then they enhanced it with CGI. In other words, for example, the missile hit, you know, Godzilla was, you know, a suited actor, but say the missile strikes were CGI. You know, some of the explosion effects when they hit Godzilla was CGI. So there is a nice meet in between. You know, I mean, you can use CGI to enhance other special effects. There's nothing wrong with that.
We'll see what happens with this one. I think once I get it, I'll let you know, and we'll watch it together, and we can critique it together for once instead of seeing it.
Let's film that and have our own Rhode Island Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Why the hell not?
We can do that at the Gardner Hill Asylum.
You got it. We'll do it.
All I can hope in this one is that Godzilla is evil.
I haven't seen or heard too much. Now, the people that have gone to see this that are my friends, which aren't very many, have not spoiled it. So that's a good side, is that they haven't
To spoil it.
Yeah, right. They haven't.
They're not bitching. They don't want to spoil it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just like I just did earlier on Chuckle's Crypt. I gave you my review of
Suicide Squad,
but I did not spoil it for people.
Right.
No.
Which a lot of people that review stuff don't know how to do that.
You can review with tact and discretion. You don't need to spoil major plot points to still say your opinion.
I'll tell you, a lot of people don't know how to review with discretion. And another thing people don't know how to do, meaning film studios anymore, they don't know how to come an attraction with discretion either.
No.
Remember the days, and this goes back a way, I'm thinking about maybe up until the 80s. Like, for example, when the first Alien movie came out, they didn't show you the story at all.
Right.
No.
I mean, you just got a very provocative image, a tagline, and coming to a theater near you, such and such a date.
Suspense.
Yeah, I mean, they didn't show you any of the story. Now it seems like every coming attraction...
trailers.
Yeah, the trailers, they last too long, and they show you the story. In other words, so you know the movie sucks, you know, when you're sitting there in the theater watching the trailer, or going online and watching the trailer. And in other words, maybe it doesn't suck, but if it doesn't suck, then you already know the damn story. So why do you want to go see it? There's
You've
no suspense
seen all
anymore.
Best parts.
I mean, it's a good thing that this didn't exist back in the days when people like Alfred Hitchcock made Psycho. Mm. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Let's give away the surprise endings. You know they would have.
Yeah.
Yeah, they definitely would have. And the other thing, Tony said that I agree with is that people don't know how to form their own opinions either. They listen to the critics and they stay home and they don't watch it.
Right.
So they don't realize that opinions are like assholes.
Right.
Everybody's got one. Right, go form your own.
Right, except...
Form your own asshole?
Yeah, that too.
Yes. But let's not get too far with this, though. I mean, my opinion is obviously worth more than other people's. I mean... Some people's opinions are worth more than other people's. I mean, why would our listeners listen to this show if they thought that my opinion was worth no more than every other idiot that has an internet radio show, right?
Right, right.
Right, so therefore, now also, I am an authority on this week's subject.
Of Godzilla. You are. There's definitely no one out there
anyone yeah. who knows me will vouch for the fact that I am an authority on the subject of Godzilla.
You know more facts about Godzilla than I do about horror movies in general, so definitely you do.
Right. So. And I also know that, just to wrap up, we were talking about the atomic bombing of Japan. Just to emphasize the fact that there really should be no hard feelings, and they really shouldn't be complaining about all that radiation we dumped on them. They didn't get enough of it, because what was it, a few years ago, they nuked themselves with their own nuclear power plants. It's like, you know what I'm saying? So they're complaining about two atomic bombs,
but
they saturated themselves. I mean, what
didn't they release even more radiation?
Yeah, I mean, who but the Japanese, lovers of radiation and atomic mutation, would build their atomic power plant, their nuclear power plants, below the high tide line in a country that gets friggin' hurricanes every year.
Which, by the way, if you have a hankering for some salmon and you go down to your local fishmonger, make sure it doesn't say a product of Japan on
put
there.
Put it this way. Anything that comes from within about 1,000 miles of Japan, Tony, you bring a Geiger counter.
And might I say, once again, the Simpsons predicted the future. They had the three-eyed fish back in the day
Blinky,
from the Springfield nuclear power plant. And now we have it today.
They did. And I'll tell you, and there have been some mutations caught in fishermen's nets.
Yeah.
I mean, this isn't all fiction anymore.
No.
I mean, we've had, 60-foot...
Fact can be stranger than fiction.
Well, except on this show.
Yeah.
But otherwise, yes. I mean, they have had mutations picked up in nets.
Yeah.
Yep.
About, what is it, 60-foot mutations?
Weird-looking fish that look like worms that people are holding up. Yeah, I've seen those. The carcasses.
The freakier one is the fish, and I think it's from nuclear radiation exposure. The fish that has a hole in its head, so basically doesn't have a brain, but it's still functioning.
In other words, the fish are taking after human beings in this regard.
Yeah, I mean, as a horror fan, that's called a zombie, right?
Right.
The fish has a hole in the head, functionally has no brain, but is swimming through the ocean.
Yeah. So that means either...
Oh, crap. Zombie fishes. That's just going to start the plague, man.
You better copyright that before sci-fi gets it.
Oh, you better, because it'll be zombie tornado.
Well, I'll tell you, if the creatures of the sea turn against us, there's been a few stories along those lines in the past, but zombie fishes, complete with holes in their head. Now, does that mean they're brainless, or does that mean the brain moved to some other part of the anatomy?
I think the brain kind of fell out. Yeah.
Huh.
Oh wow! So this hole rotted in the head from the radiation, and the brain just kind of
brain kind of rolled out somewhere in the water,
and it's still functioning.
Impressive.
Oh.
Yeah, but anyway, so like I say, and this is all a result of the Japanese self-radiating by melting down a bunch of nuclear power plants during a tsunami or earthquake or something.
Because apparently, why not?
Yeah. Well, they wanted to make more Godzilla movies. They thought franchise was getting stale.
That's why it was so much bigger. They were just trying to make Godzilla bigger.
Yeah. Now, of course. Yeah.
And speaking of truth being stranger than a fiction, in a true movie-like crescendo, they almost have the nuclear reactors under control at one point, but then they run out of fresh water. So they decide, we're going to use seawater. The seawater rusts the reactors, and they're back where they started. I mean, you couldn't write anything better than that.
No.
You couldn't. I thought the Russians were the stupidest people on the face of the earth when it came to dealing with nuclear power.
Oh, no.
I mean, shutting off the safety, shutting off the fallback safety systems at the Chernobyl power plant as part of a drill and then not being able to get them turned on again.
Yeah.
Ruh-roh. Just imagine being the poor $10 an hour third shift Japanese security guard. at that nuclear power plant.
I think probably the Japanese security guard making $10 an hour was the first guy out of there.
True. He was like, oh, something doesn't smell right. I'm out of here.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, he saw those needles just start to move a little bit toward the red. And like, no, the security guard, he was out of there.
He's
yeah.
already over here in America,
it's
and
all
he works at it.
Engineers that were down there saying, oh, I can fix this. Oh, I can fix this. Oh, I can't fix this.
Exactly.
They all work at Electric Boat now as supervisors.
Yeah, with holes in their head. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, but this begs the question, and it also belabors the point. I mean, we know how Godzilla got here, but Chuckles, what is there about a 400-foot dragon who breathes radioactive fire, stomps on buildings that, I don't know, that makes
reminds
us
me of a few of my ex-girlfriends.
Well, yeah, they didn't exactly breathe fire, but their breath, yes, definitely left... It's like, hey, this is so-and-so, and it's, yeah, let me step back. But, yeah, what is it that makes us love
smells
this
like
creature,
cold cuts.
Godzilla, so much?
For myself to love it,
yeah, I mean,
one of the
yeah,
reasons I like it so much is it reminds me of a giant mutated dinosaur crushing and destroying other dinosaur-like
like
creatures.
You're like fire-breathing T-Rex.
And yeah, and I enjoy that.
Yeah, destroying other creatures or destroying the people?
Both. It's entertaining in both ways. I mean, it'd get boring if it just squished the people all the time and you didn't have a giant monster to fight them back.
Well, absolutely.
Yeah,
who's your favorite Godzilla opponent?
My all-time favorite is Ghidorah.
Ghidorah, the three-headed monster.
All-time favorite. And then probably the second one that is a close runner-up would probably be Bilanti. Kind of like
that
him.
That was cool.
I like the first form of him with all the different...
Yeah, the giant plant with the rose with teeth.
Yeah, I did like that a lot. That was a good one. And I always like Mecha Godzilla. That's an awesome battle to see.
Yeah, that's like Ali Frazier. That's a reliable one.
Yeah, that's going to happen in one shape or form. If Godzilla takes back to the Earth again somewhere down the road, the Mecha Godzilla is going to show up and try to kick his butt.
Yeah,
Gigan was pretty cool, too. But I don't think he got enough spotlight as the other ones did.
Right. As far as Biollante, I thought it was a really good movie. I thought the fight at the end was a little bit of a WCW gyp, though.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, you know, first they gave Godzilla that virus that weakened him. Then the fight with Biollante at the end only lasted about, 2 minutes of the film. It was inconclusive, you know. But while it lasted, good stuff.
Yeah, I got to ask you this. Is it cannibalistic to do what I do when I watch Godzilla versus the Sea Monster?
Which is?
I have a lobster in front of me, and I pretend I'm Godzilla as I'm ripping apart the said lobster, which is supposed to be the Sea Monster on Godzilla.
Now, do you get the lobster from the seafood store, cook it up, and wait for the movie, or is this...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he fights it live.
Yeah, I fight it live. I eat it raw.
He even takes off the elastic band.
Well, no, of course not. Cannibalism is only if you eat your own kind. You're not related. You're not related to that lobster.
Yeah, no, but I was just thinking, because that's one of my guilty pleasures is to sit there with that. And also, for some reason, Chinese food is a guilty pleasure while watching Godzilla. And they're two different nations, but for me, they go hand in hand. Yeah.
I'll tell you one guilty secret about Godzilla versus the Sea Monster is, if you're not aware of it, that was supposed to be a King Kong movie.
Really? I did not know that.
Yeah, there was a couple. If you watched again, there's a couple of scenes in that movie where Godzilla takes a girl captive. You know, one of the island girls. Godzilla kind of takes a fancy to her and keeps her there close to him, until she sneaks away later on. But yeah, there's a couple of dead giveaways that was supposed to be a King Kong movie which is actually a good thing that it wasn't, because we've seen the way the Japanese make Godzilla King Kong suits.
Yeah.
For some reason, they're really good at giant reptiles, but they cannot make a gorilla suit to save their lives.
He did look silly.
Yeah, it's all about the fur.
It
they
was fun, but he definitely looked silly.
Definitely looked silly. So, yeah, so I think that's cooler heads prevailed.
He had googly eyes.
Yeah.
How do you get
Minnie Pearl's hat.
Rights, but not monkey eyes?
I don't know. He just had, like, these googly eyes every time he got hit. Or
Miranda.
Godzilla would torture
me. Yeah, they were like glassy Grover the Monster eyes.
Yeah,
like
it'll take
something
from Sesame Street versus Godzilla.
Yeah.
Oh, we should do that. The Cookie Monster versus
Godzilla.
Godzilla.
But yeah, so no, they made a good choice replacing King Kong with Godzilla and Godzilla versus the Sea Monster.
Now, did you see the trailer for the new Kong? Speaking about all things monsters and everything.
Not yet.
Oh, boy, did I. And it doesn't give away too much.
Gives away plenty, right?
Not really.
No? Oh,
not
it doesn't?
Not really. It does give away a lot, but it does kind of give away that the monster is big.
Bigger.
A lot bigger than Peter Jackson's or the originals. It's huge. That's the only thing I'm going to leave it at. They've shown scripts of that or 5 seconds of that. I think it's going to be a really good movie. I have to say, I'm going to like it. I haven't been really disappointed with the Kong movies.
Now, who's responsible for this?
I don't know.
This new Kong movie.
I don't know. I'll have to have Nurse Misery do her job and look it up when she comes back instead of picking off her nail polish and eating it.
I wasn't eating it. It was bothering my cuticle.
She was snorting it.
Yeah, she was snorting it. This is what I think of Kong and his googly eyes.
All right, let's go. Well, Nurse Misery enjoys the effects of that snorted nail polish. Let's go back to the music for a second. Let's do some Blue Oyster Cult. Nosferatu here in the Haunted Cabaret, Rhode Island, Free Radio.
Oh,
are back celebrating the 50th. What birthday is it now of Godzilla?
For Godzilla?
For Godzilla. Let's see, because the atomic bomb went off in 45, which, you know, I know Chuckles on your show, you wanted to designate that. And there's some, you know, that's, I can see that. I can get behind that. The explosion of the atomic bomb in Hiroshima was really the birth of Godzilla. So that's very 45.
And then the first movie was 54.
And the first movie was 54.
Had some time to grow up before destroying
things. So it depends. If you want to, you know, which birthday you want to celebrate. Celebrate
the
both of them.
First out of the water or the first, like, the actual birth.
Why not celebrate both of them? I mean,
celebrate both of them.
We celebrate both days for H.P. Lovecraft, his death and his birth. So.
And to add to that, there is an actual Godzilla Day in Japan, which is November 3rd.
There you go. Celebrate it three times.
We guess, yeah, definitely. I would like to go to that. Godzilla Day in Japan. That would be pretty cool. Do a live broadcast from that.
Now, I'd be interested. Now, how do they treat that Godzilla Day? How do they treat it? Is it just like a strictly commercial Disney thing?
No, it seems like they actually treat it with some kind of reverence because it's also Japanese Culture Day.
Okay.
So they look at it as part of their
national culture.
Their cinematographic culture over the years.
All right. So, yeah, so they do give it its appropriate. Wow. Because the interesting thing is, why? No, I'm just going to leave it at that. That's no, really, I'm not. I don't know enough about it, and yeah, I can see that mixed attitude toward it. As a matter of fact, the best mixed attitude toward Godzilla is in the film Giant Monster All Out Attack, when his name escapes me. Director of Giant Monster All Out Attack. Nurse Misery.
Nurse Misery.
Yeah.
See, we have, for some reason, I don't know, maybe it's the extreme humidity that we've been going through? Everything's sluggish.
I think so. It might be. And, of course, the evil seed's not helping her out too much.
I'm becoming a slowed down slug. So I'm looking for a Giant Monster what now?
All Out Attack.
All Out Attack.
Yeah. In the meantime, what I'll mention, Chuckles, you mentioned Mechagodzilla, which is, I think Mechagodzilla is all kaiju fans one of their favorites.
Is that your favorite villain?
No.
Okay, which one is yours? So now we know.
Probably my favorite Godzilla opponent.
Okay.
Would probably be. You know what? It might be. Look. Let me differentiate here. Two things. You know, like when we were talking about the Joker on your show, and I said, which Joker are we talking about?
Yep.
Now, in the Godzilla series, which stretches from 54 to the present day, there's basically two versions of Mechagodzilla. Now, in the 90s onward, Mechagodzilla was strictly a robot. You know, he had a human crew inside, and he was a robot. Now, in the 1970s, the original Godzilla series, Mechagodzilla was a cyborg, and he had a human interface. And what they did is they took brain tissue from the scientist's daughter, used it to put the finishing touches on Mechagodzilla's brain.
Of course.
And it was the girl who powered Mechagodzilla with her emotions. They brainwashed her into a hatred for mankind. Hmm. And it was the girl's emotions who powered Mechagodzilla. In other words, he could fire up, but he wouldn't kill until she ordered him to kill. In other words, I guess that would be a brain meeting of the minds is what it was. But symbiosis, is that the right word?
You're asking the wrong clown. If you want scientific, you gotta get Bozo over here, not me.
I think you were going for a symbiotic relationship.
Symbiotic relationship. Right, they need each other.
Exactly. One can't exist without the other.
Right. Right. And Mechagodzilla can exist, but he can't fully function.
Yeah.
Without her interface.
Yeah.
Yeah. That version of Mechagodzilla might be my favorite.
Wasn't the 90s one ran by some sort of cockroach creatures at the end? They destroyed it, they saw the cockroaches come out from...
That was Gigan, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
That was your buddy Gigan.
Yes, okay. I got that one confused.
Godzilla versus Gigan, which was Godzilla and Anguirus teamed up against Gigan and Ghidorah, the three-headed monster.
Okay.
Right, and it was cockroach aliens that brought Gigan to Earth and Ghidorah, you know, to fight Godzilla and Angus. So, yeah, that was the cockroach aliens.
I love those storylines.
Yeah, I mean, what gets better than cockroach aliens?
Nothing.
Cockroach aliens leading Gigan and Ghidorah to fight Godzilla and Angus in a kid's amusement park.
Yeah, it was awesome.
That's hard to top right there.
Yeah, except the original creators of Mechagodzilla, if I'm not mistaken, were ape refugees from the planet of the apes.
Really?
Yeah. They were ape-like creatures.
Huh.
It was the cosmic monster, rather, Mechagodzilla, the first appearance of Mechagodzilla, was originally called Godzilla versus the Cosmic Monster when it was released here in the United States. Godzilla versus Mechagodzilla in Japan. And the aliens who brought us the first Mechagodzilla movie were these creatures that looked like apes. They looked human until they died, and then their faces turned back into apes. Now,
You know, that's pretty cool.
It is. Then the second time Mechagodzilla, and by the way, this part of the show is for ultra kaiju nerds only. Okay? But the second Mechagodzilla appearance was after Godzilla had destroyed Mechagodzilla and Godzilla versus the Cosmic Monster. The second film was The Terror of Mechagodzilla, in which another set of aliens, and it's amazing how many sets of aliens just feel obligated to attack Japan with giant monsters. It's always amazing to me. But yeah, this new race of aliens dive down and found the head of Mechagodzilla, which Godzilla had torn off and thrown in the ocean at the end of the first movie. They reconstructed Mechagodzilla, and they're the ones that interfaced the scientist's daughter, the human brain tissue, with Mechagodzilla cybernetic tissue to create the ultimate, as they said in the movie, the ultimate robot monster.
Damn those aliens.
I'll tell you. Yeah. Naturally, and I'll tell you, that was one fight. I mean, unless Godzilla had it specifically written into his contract that he was going to win, you know, kind of like Hulk Hogan and Kevin Nash like. Even as much of a Godzilla fan as I am, that was a fight that Godzilla should have lost if it had been on the up and up and hadn't been fixed.
Speaking about aliens and Godzilla, How cool would it be if a queen facehugger got herself attached to Godzilla? Imagine that creature coming out of that stomach. That's something to draw a picture of out there.
Except it probably wouldn't happen. Because even if the face hugger sent its tentacle down into Godzilla's stomach, the nuclear radioactivity inside Godzilla would basically fry the baby alien.
Alien
fetus.
Aliens are filled with acid, so
how
would acid
could survive
burn
in outer space? So, you know, they show like the queen getting locked out and thrown out into outer space, and that's very radioactive and
she only survives for a few minutes.
We don't know that. All they do is they show her go out
and float away.
We don't know if those bugs can't survive in outer space. Keeping in mind, they're bugs, and they adapt really easily.
Well, I doubt it, but I won't say 100%. I won't say the idea is 100% cannot do.
Someone should draw it for us.
Well, I know that the only thing I can come close to on that one is that when he fought the monster Orga in Godzilla 2000.
I remember Orga.
Yeah, what Orga tried to do was
eat him.
Basically like swallow him like an amoeba and suck out his life energy, suck out the Godzilla cells, you know, the energy in the Godzilla cells, which backfired because that's what happened to Orga, is basically he dissolved enough of Godzilla's skin that the nuclear radiation from inside him basically just cooked Orga like a microwave oven.
That movie took way too long for Orga to show. Way too long. Good movie, but I was pissed on how long that flying saucer was in the air.
Hovering there, yeah.
And then how little of a battle they gave you of Orga and Godzilla. It's like, wow, you really just screwed me with that.
Right. And what I didn't like about that was, if you think about it, it stole quite a bit from Independence Day.
Yeah.
If you remember that flying saucer hovering over
and
the building.
And everybody's looking at it like, oh, what's that?
Right. Yeah, and then the way it destroyed the building. Yeah, that was a little... I don't mind borrowing from a movie you like, but that was a little blatant.
Oh, man. ID4 aliens bringing their version of a Godzilla down. We're toast. I mean, they had that... Oh, that would be cool. They had that giant queen from ID4 versus Godzilla. So, that would be awesome.
They're about the same size, stature, and everything. Yeah. That would be a pretty brutal team.
Yeah. Right, as we contemplate that, let's go back to the music. How about a little Exhumed, Vacant Grave, here on the Haunted Cabaret on Rhode Island Free Radio. Back. That was Vacant Grave by Exhumed here in the Haunted Cabaret. And this week we're talking about all things Godzilla. And one of the questions that always arises, now, you know, most people who know me recognize me as basically, as I said before, basically one of the finest authorities on Godzilla walking this planet. And I take pride in that. So I'm not averse to answering any and all questions. And one of the questions that's asked me most often by scoffers is, why does Godzilla keep attacking Japan again and again and again and again and again? And they look at me like, oh, you can't answer this one. It's got to be for a stupid reason and you can't answer it. Well, au contrary. Surprise, surprise, it's not a stupid reason. Now, it took until one of our later films, the Giant Monster All-Out Attack that I mentioned, directed by Shusuke Kaneko, and he only got to make one Godzilla film because the entire Japanese, the entire Japanese entertainment industry got so pissed off at him because of the story he told in his one and only shot at Godzilla. Now, Kaneko, he had been the architect of the Gamera trilogy, which was Chuckles, you've seen these. They were some of the best giant monster movies in years.
Oh, I love Gamera flicks.
Yeah, especially these three. Like the quality was incredible. A beautiful blend of suitmation and CGI. And so Toho looked at these Gamera films and said, compared to this, our latest Godzilla movies are crap. So what they did is they hired Shusuke Kaneko over from Daiei Studios to make a Godzilla film. And the Godzilla film that he made answered the question, why does Godzilla keep attacking Japan again and again and again? And the answer, for all you folks who have been wondering throughout the years, is that Godzilla attacks because of the atrocities committed by the Japanese during World War II. In other words, Godzilla is the personification of the souls of all the innocent people who were murdered at the hands of the Japanese military in those atrocities I mentioned earlier. And that's why, number one, Godzilla can't be killed. And number two, the reason he comes back once every generation. In other words, he destroys the country when they rebuild, and most importantly, when the Japanese people forget what they did. And they show signs by their exuberance and their self-indulgence that they have forgotten the atrocities their country perpetrated. That's when Godzilla attacks again.
So Godzilla is the ultimate history nerd.
Godzilla is the ultimate history nerd. The souls who animate and possess Godzilla, I guess, would be the ultimate history Wikipedia, because they are not going to let you forget. That's why, you know,
Godzilla could have a show on H2.
Probably could.
I would watch it a lot more than some of those shows on H2.
But anyway, yes, so that is the reason. What, now, as far as why all these other monsters see fit to attack Japan, I can't help you on that.
I think it's a sport. I think it's a hobby. Posers. I think it's a sport. See who can destroy the most buildings. They got a competition.
Right.
You think there's a tally board underwater or something?
Yeah, there's a tally board. It's like, okay, today Ghidorah is going to go down and do it.
I was going to say, but who books it?
Ooh, I'm going to say it's Gamera. Gamera books it, because okay. He never shows up anyways besides to save children. So it's Gamera.
Gamera, or do you think Mothra might be the booker?
No, because even Mothra destroys the towns.
But even the booker's got to get in on the action every now and then.
No. It's Gamera.
Actually, my thinking would be one of the alien races.
Yeah, it could be that, or it could be Ultron.
Cockroach alien thingies.
Just because we lost a few cockroach aliens in Godzilla vs. Gamera doesn't mean Godzilla vs. Gigan doesn't mean they're not still around somewhere.
Yeah, maybe it is. It's cockroach people.
Well, we got a hint of it. If you remember in King Kong vs. Godzilla, as much as some of us Godzilla fans would like to forget that one, there was the great scene toward the beginning when the promoter, Rumba, wanted to bring King Kong to Japan so he could have a monster of his own.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, that's, yeah, I mean... Now, I sympathize. I mean, who in their right mind wouldn't want to see a giant monster fight? So I'm thinking it's maybe like the Don King or the Donald Trump or the Vince McMahon of Japan. You know, maybe.
Yeah.
There you go. It's good for the economy.
That's how they rebuild
really
so
good.
Quickly.
Yeah, it helps put people to work. It helps.
Warm
it's really good.
Jobs.
Are you listening, Donald Trump? Flatten the East and West Coast of America and the industrial heartland with a giant monster attack.
Yeah.
And, yeah, why not?
You know, it would be a little ironic if there was a giant lizard coming up through Florida squishing things, just since there's so many crocodiles down there anyways.
Oh, you want a giant crocodile?
Yeah.
Yeah, why not? We'll do that. Yeah, giant alligator that. Going up eating people.
Yeah,
we'll do that, too.
How are we doing for time, by the way?
About 10 minutes left, and let's see. The next track I have queued up is only a minute and 50 seconds long.
All right. That means we have quite a bit of bullshit time left.
Yeah.
And when you're discussing the subject of Godzilla, there's never enough.
I'm going to go down there and stab these guys, however they think they're a band below us.
Yeah, I don't think it's being picked up on... Tony, it's not being picked up, is it?
It doesn't pick up on our microphones. However, think about the professionals in this building.
Yeah.
There's people here trying to commence commerce, and there's just nut jobs downstairs doing God knows what.
Yeah.
It's a unique sound this evening.
Yeah, our listeners can't pick this up, which is probably good because we'd have too much bleed through and ruin the audio on the show.
Yeah.
But below our studio... I guess you would call it in the dungeon of or the depths of the building.
Yes.
I'm not Tony just called it a band. I'm not quite sure what you would call it. It's not quite a band. It's kind of like
noise.
It's noise, but in a negative sense.
Nega noise. I don't know. I'm making up stuff, George. I'm trying here.
Which is funny because the landlord here nicely and politely asked me not to play the drums before 7 o'clock p.m., which I don't have a problem with.
Right.
However, if I come here at any time of the day, those nut jobs are down there making some kind of crazy noise.
Fantastic.
Maybe, I don't know, maybe he's scared of them.
Or I haven't seen the landlord in a while. He might be down there tied up.
Oh, my, that'd be terrifying.
Yeah, I don't know. We think that there's some kind of combination sex temple.
We haven't heard weird noises from upstairs in a very long time.
That's because they're not there anymore.
Yeah, they're gone.
Oh, that's why.
Their cult didn't last. I don't know what they were worshiping upstairs, but. Maybe
I kind of missed their noises. It was much better than those lower noises.
Well, the thing is, when you worship something from upstairs, it's never as potent as worshiping something downstairs.
Now, to set the scene for our listeners, the folks that were upstairs above our studio here were literal holy rollers. So when the spirit struck them, they would roll around on the floor.
Yeah.
Right.
And you would hear bodies rolling on the floor and dropping out of nowhere and...
Right.
It was entertaining.
Well, we're still not sure what they worshipped. I mean, the sky gods, we don't know. But what's downstairs, Tony, how would you characterize that?
Take a confused 16-year-old goth kid who decides he wants to start an art rock band, so he goes to the flea market to buy the cheapest instruments possible to start said art rock band, books a show at AS220, and starts practicing.
Right, except that these gentlemen look to be in their mid to late 40s.
Mid to late hundreds.
Mid to late,
I thought they used to just watch movies and...
And have sex.
Yeah. It sounded like porn noises. It used to. Now it sounds like dying cats.
The porn noises were authentic. I mean, when one of them started bellowing as he,
That's easier to ignore, and it's funnier. This is painful.
Yeah.
Look, the moaning's back. Yay!
It wasn't moaning. They didn't moan down there.
That sounds like moaning now, though.
No, that's synthesizer moaning.
Yeah.
No, there was the audio from the participants themselves was more like bellowing.
Yeah, it's
Whatever it is, making me horny. Whatever it is, it's making me horny.
I'm leaving. I'm out. I'm going right out that window right now.
Unfortunately, I think we're all leaving. I think time's just about up. All right, let's get out of here with a little... Yeah, I like the word in relation to the people downstairs, too. But let's get a little slayer. maybe we'll go downstairs.
The name of this song is what is allegedly happening downstairs right now.
Yes. Sex, murder, art. And as soon as we're off the air, it might not be in that order. All right. So this is a wrap for this week's edition of the Haunted Cabaret. See you next time. Nighty night.